Welcome back. I'm joined by Emma Gonzalez, one of the survivors of February's Parkland school shooting, as well as Bria Smith and Matt Post, two student activists who've joined with Emma in the March for Our Lives movement. Guys, welcome to AM to DM.
Hello.
Thank you for having us.
Now, you guys are wrapping up this Road to Change bus tour. You were just telling me how many stops you've been at, something like 70 stops around the country?
Over 70 stops.
Amazing.
Over 90 events so far.
Amazing. This is all to promote an end to gun violence. And I want to tell me what it's been like in the more conservative parts of the country that you guys have visited. What's the reaction been like?
We get a lot of protesters at our events, even though our events are set up to communicate with protesters, and making separate events is kind of a lot.
Yeah.
But, you know, we have, you know, people go out to meet them, people of our team, you know, usually Matt Deitcher, David, and go out to meet with them and talk with them and settle differences. And at the end of their conversations, everybody's pretty much 90% in agreement about, everybody's on the same page.
That's nice.
We have our 10 policy points on our website, and a lot of them are not even anything to do with the Second Amendment. For the record, we are a pro-Second Amendment organization, and we have no problem with guns existing in America. We want a safer America.
Sure.
And that means, you know, extreme risk protection orders or anti-gun violence advocacy.
Sure. There's some people also going, Matt.
I would just say, I think outside of op-ed pages, Twitter, and Congress, this is not a polarizing issue for anybody.
Right.
97% of the country supports universal background checks, 67% support a ban on semi-automatic rifles, the same percentages for things like ATF digitalization and violence intervention programs. This is a hugely popular agenda, and we're just trying to get Congress to follow the will of the American people.
There are people who are skeptical of you guys, and I wonder, they would say, is your goal just to get people to vote for Democrats in the midterms?
Oh no, it's not about left or right. It's not about who we're voting for in the midterms. It's about acknowledging that gun violence is so versatile, and it's a big conversation in aspects. I come from inner city, and I experience day-by-day gun violence, and that gets overlooked in media and all the platforms. And like, we need to promote that we are all together, that we're inclusive with our message, diverse in our message, because so many different people coming from perspectives of gun violence that are not given the seat at the table, not given the ability to sit on this couch, the opportunity to talk with you. And we're not about pushing the agenda of who to vote for, who not to vote for. We're trying to educate youth and educate anyone that has the ability and the opportunity to vote for people that represent them as an American citizen, that represent them and elect them, and morally just leaders that elect them into office. It's not about who we're voting for.
The reality is, though, isn't it, that there is one party that is more pro reducing gun violence than the other at the moment, who are more pro behind the Second Amendment. So is the goal then to try to make your campaign platform a kind of litmus test for people on the left in terms of, if they want to get elected, they have to subscribe to your beliefs here?
We have a saying that we don't advocate for people, we advocate for policy. So it doesn't matter who you are as a person, it matters if you want to save somebody's life in the long term or not.
As Bria said, we're not interested in left versus right, red versus blue. We're only interested in morally just leaders, people who are going to follow what the American people want and do what the right thing is for saving American lives.
Bria, you mentioned coming from an inner city, and I know that you support Black Lives Matter. I wonder, do you feel that the March for Our Lives movement has done enough to reach out to students of color in the inner city?
I just want to show this hug right now.
Yeah.
Because this is what they don't want to see. They don't want to see diversity within a message that's for everyone. You can't talk about gun violence if you're not talking about mass incarceration that's related to gun violence, the school-to-prison pipeline that's related to gun violence, all the aspects that has an entire conversation in one box. Because in my community, gun violence is a prevalent condition reality for lots of people. Growing up, I thought that hearing gunshots in the distance before going to sleep was normal. And when I came on tour, I met with all these different people. They're like, that's not normal. That reality that you have growing up is false, and it shouldn't be the narrative for brown and black youth in your community. So being in March for Our Lives, being inclusive and diversifying this message, because it's not just about mass shootings in white suburban areas where predominantly white students. It's about mass shootings that are happening every single day where students are walking to their house and getting shot and killed by a stray bullet.
Amen.
It's about police brutality that is gun violence. And we need to talk about all those issues that conclude this gun violence conversation.
Matt, what would you say to a young student who's just becoming politically aware? Maybe they're growing up under their parents and they're used to having their parents' politics in form their own politics. What would you say to that person?
We have the entirety of human knowledge at our fingertips. It's so easy to research and find different things out about different candidates. And I'd also say the only way we're going to change things is for everyone to get involved. You can't just register to vote and vote. There's a lot that has to happen in between. Door knock, canvas, phone bank, everything you can do to get other people out to vote.
Emma, we know that Barron Trump's school staged a walkout when you guys did the mass day of walkouts. We don't know whether or not he participated, but I'm wondering, do you have a message for Barron Trump, the son of the president?
I hope he's having a good day.
Yes.
Yeah?
Go Barron.
Do you hope that this is an issue that he and his dad discuss?
I would hope that everybody in this country is discussing this issue. Doesn't matter who, everybody should be worried about the fact that gun violence can affect anybody at any given time. Even if it's not intentional, as Bria was saying, you can get hit by a stray bullet at any time. Bullets don't discriminate.
And we like to say, bullets see no face, they don't see color. Like, everyone can be a victim, everyone could have a name on their bullet.
Parkland was the safest city in Florida for 8 years running, and 17 people died and 17 people were injured, like, after, of course, Pulse 2 years earlier. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't matter who you are, where you live, what your socioeconomic status is, what your skin color is, what your sexuality is. Anything in this country, doesn't matter who you are, you can get hit by a bullet.
The NRA said in a court filing last week that they are losing financial capital as a result of some stuff that's going on here in New York since the Parkland movement. You're pulling a face there. So it doesn't seem like you buy that argument too much. You don't think that they're suffering too
much?
Oh, no,
they are, and I'm happy.
Oh, they are?
Because the National Rifle Association used to stand for safety. And when people have weapons or firearms, excuse me, when they have firearms, they actually would, you know, protect people's usage of that. They'd be like, you need to have safe storage. You need to have a permit. You need to train it with it. And now it's like, we're going to take money from the gun companies, the companies that manufacture weapons of this caliber. And when there's mass shootings, we're going to make more money. So we're going to encourage politicians to say what we want them to say so that we will continue to get more money in the long run and not be the company that people used to think we are.
So that was you literally sipping tea as that was happening.
Thank you for catching that.
Thank you. Sorry. Good. Okay.
Shot of that by the
end. We will make a gift. We got a whole team to make gift. Don't worry. We'll send you the gift. I want to say the tour is wrapping up in Newtown this weekend, and that got me thinking because Newtown's been in a bit the news this week because of Alex Jones and his ilk at InfoWars and conspiracy theorists like him. He's hounded some of these families for years, and you, Emma, you know a bit about what it's like to be on the receiving end of online abuse and online conspiracy theories. I'm wondering, though, this medium that we're on now, Twitter, is one of the few mediums that hasn't taken any action against Alex Jones and InfoWars. If you could tell Jack Dorsey, the head of Twitter, give him a peek inside what it's like to be you on Twitter, on what it's like to be you online, what would you want him and other tech CEOs to know?
He already knows. I've had a conversation with him before. He's
oh,
a
really?
Cool man. He's a lovely man.
What did you tell him?
I said hi. It was like the first day I'd ever been like out on Twitter, and like we actually went to Twitter headquarters in the very beginning of everything and stuff, and he was like, hey guys, and I was like, hey man. Everybody sees the abuse that people face online, and I'm gonna switch the topic a little bit more to the fact that there's videos of people making pipe bombs on YouTube, like tutorials on stuff like that, but you know, people get gay videos taken down, like people saying hi I'm gay type of videos, and those get taken down. Like, there's an extreme problem in this country with censorship that leads more to Nazis should have, you know, freedom of speech, and people who are living their life in a safe and comfortable way every day, their rights are being infringed because other people are uncomfortable seeing love.
Right.
And it's just like going off the topic where they pick and choose who gets the media platform and the coverage for different issues. Like, it's like a minority issue where if you're not giving this platform and this media coverage because what you're saying is not the mass majority of what is going on in the conversation. So that's what's unfair about lots of media coverage.
I mean, I think it speaks to this broader issue, which is this outsized influence of Nazis and weirdos and freaks on our politics. And what this movement is about is uniting people from all sides of the political spectrum who want normalcy and a compassionate government and a more equitable nation. And that's what this tour has been about, and that's what March for Our Lives is about.
Emma, I want to go back to the March for Our Lives speak protest that you guys had in D.C. and that incredible moment that was you on stage. I'm wondering what went into your mind in terms of that silent protest that you did on stage, and can you tell us what was going through your head as that was happening?
I was looking in the distance because, like, the street was converging in the distance as, like, perspective, and there was, like, a box in front of the mountain, and I was like, all right, I'm going to look there. And like literally not a thought passed through my mind. Of course, there are other moments where you can see me obviously getting more upset, me being like, I feel so incredibly sad right now. Mm-hmm. And like, it was a low place for everybody. And like, that was like, the whole point of that silence was to create an environment in which people could be upset, mm-hmm. because it was a rough time period. But like, and I'm getting emotional talking about it now because like I'm remembering that mindset, yeah. but it was important to do.
Yeah, it was very powerful to watch.
Thank you.
Yeah. Just lastly, since February, and we've had more school shootings, more tragedies, more deaths. Do you guys get disillusioned?
Can I just pop in and say one thing? Our movement is not just about school shootings. We
true.
Are
no.
as equally committed to stopping what
well,
happened
yeah,
in Parkland as the 30 people who were shot in Chicago on Sunday and the 7 people who were shot in Philly yesterday. We're fighting violence of all kinds.
Okay. But we haven't had any federal laws changed. And I'm wondering
but
how
we have had over 50 individual state laws passed, not us specifically, but in the time since the shooting mm-hmm. at my high school, there have been countless state laws mm-hmm. passed. We had an extreme risk protection order passed in Florida that would have taken the shooter at my school's mm-hmm. tragedy, would have taken his guns away,
yeah.
but it didn't because we didn't have an extreme risk protection order. That got passed, and a school shooting at the second largest university in the United States was stopped because
yeah.
of that. Somebody had been stocking guns on campus. They found out, they stopped him, they took his guns away, and they prevented another mass shooting at a school where there are 60,000 students.
Amazing.
So we've gotten a lot done.
Amen.
That like, you know, like on a small scale that other people like, yeah. nobody wants to hear about like something yeah. that could have happened to
yeah.
them like that. Mm-hmm. But like, it's important to remember, not only have we stopped things legally, but we've changed so many minds
yeah.
that we've stopped so many other things yeah. in contribution to that.
Well, keep doing what you're doing. Keep changing minds. Keep saving lives. Emma, Bria, Matt, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Best of luck wrapping up your March for Our Lives tour this weekend. More AM to DM is up next. Thanks, guys.
Thank you
so much.